Good evening, everyone. Welcome to today's workshop. Today is the second day of the workshop, which started yesterday. I hope all of you have attended yesterday workshop. In case if you have missed, just let us know. I kindly request all the participants follow the rules. You have to keep your camera on during login. All the participants, please.
Sir, I have missed yesterday workshop.
You have done the yesterday workshop or you missed it?
Sir, I have missed it.
Okay, you have missed it. No problem. Don't worry. So, as I promised yesterday, we're gonna have a discussion today about, you know, that few participants, you know, that you're gonna talk about yourself a little bit, about yourself, where are you from, and what you do basically, just quickly. You don't need to be so much in details. We just want to interact and to know each other, that who are our colleagues, who are other people, you know, that who is learning with us, so that in future, if there is some, you know, that help we can do to each other, we should support each other. That's the main idea, to know each other. So who want to start? Should I take one by one or are you going to start by your own?
We are going to start by own, sir. May I?
Yes, please. You have to Afshan, you have to start again.
Okay, sir. I'm Afshan Shirin. I'm from Pakistan. I recently completed about one
Afshan,
year ago.
Your camera is not visible. Can you switch on your camera?
I am Afshan from Pakistan. I did recently Master in Engineering and Water Resources Engineering from UAT Peshawar. I actually interested in R because of my research. I am doing climate change impact assessment on dam reservoir. For this purpose, I am interested in R to use it in my field or to pursue PhD.
Thank you. Most welcome. Next participants.
Sir, may I?
Yes, please.
My name is Asna Srishtha. I'm from Nepal. And I work as Environment Officer in Department of Environment under Ministry of Forest and Environment. And currently, I want to do research in air pollution. So I think this course would be very much helpful to me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, please.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Sorry.
I am Pushparas Podil from Nepal.
Go ahead. Okay, may I?
Go ahead.
I am Neo Matinya and I'm from South Africa. I have started with my PhD and I'm intending on using R for my statistical analysis. So thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Hi, I'm Surendran. I'm from India. I've been working as an automation test lead with PCS for the last 5 years. Now I'm in a plan to take up data science with Python. So I thought this statistic analysis with the R is going to help me out with the data science course. With it.
Okay. Next, please.
Hey, hello.
Yes, please.
I'm Mohammed Matloub. I'm working in King Saud University. My research is from genomic side. So I think R will help me in my research and for my analysis, because in genomic you have big data and R is very helpful with that. So that's why I started learning R.
Awesome, awesome. Next, please. We'll take 2-3 more participants. After that, we'll go to the course. Yeah, next.
Okay, let me introduce. My name is Karmayangdin and I'm from Bhutan. And I'm working as a school guidance counselor. And I'm taking this R foundation for the second time. And I would like to take up researches in future. So that's why I'm interested to learn. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, please.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, my name is Marcel Kwaku. I'm from the Ivory Coast, Cote d'Ivoire, West Africa. Mm-hmm. And I'm a customer. And currently, I'm doing my PhD in climate change and disaster risk management. I'm interested in the coastal flooding, something like that in my country. So thank you very much.
Welcome, welcome. Thank you. Next, please. Who is coming next?
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, good evening.
Good evening, good evening.
Yeah, me Govinda Prasad Dungana from Nepal, sir.
Yes. Please tell us about yourself a little bit to others. They will know about you.
Yes, sir. Me Govinda Prasad Dungana from Nepal. I am PhD scholar in statistics, sir. So this package is very fruitful for me, sir.
Good, good, Govindji. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Any other participants?
Good evening. This is Abdulzahar Mustafa from King Saud University in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. I am the botany and biotechnology department. I'm working in genetics and genetic diversity, and I also need this question.
Okay. Most welcome. Yeah, next, please.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. My name is Sheikh Omar Lee. I'm from Ivory Coast, Africa Rice. I work in Africa Rice. Mm-hmm. I'm a research assistant in plant breeding. Mm. This is my first time to join this training. I hope I will get many things here. Thank you.
For sure. Most welcome. Anybody else?
Thank you.
We'll take the last participants. After that, we'll go to the course. Last one.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Your video is not coming. You have to start your camera. Rest, we can hear you. Anyone else? Okay, so
good afternoon.
We'll do this introduction part again tomorrow because we have limited time, you know that. So I take 5-10 minutes of starting time to introduce each other, to know each other. So don't leave this, you know, the experience to explore the world, you know. This is the best platform, I say, that where you can learn and you can make connections also with the world, where all you see that people from India, from Pakistan, from Nepal, from South Africa, Malaysia, Bhutan, name it. I mean, you will see people from different part of the world here. So in different workshop you go, you meet different people from the all around the world. So the best place to get introduced to each other. You never know that somebody can helpful for you in future. So apart from learning, we make connections also here on Psychoanalytica. So that is what I believe, that when you introduce yourself, people know that what you do. And when you speak about yourself, maybe somebody looking for, you know, that your profile or portfolio for their reference. So it's best practice to speak about yourself whenever you get chance, right? So thank you very much, all of you. We'll start this session now. Professor, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. All the participants, please keep your microphone muted, except Dr. Parmar. Sir, we can start now. Parmar, sir, are you there? Looks like his internet has some instability issue today. There was some internet issue at his end today. His internet provider has some issue. So we still have some time until he comes online. Can anybody else, you can talk about yourself. We still have some time.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. This is Praveen here. Basically, I'm an IT professional from Sri Lanka. Currently, I'm working in the field of AI and machine learning. So my major is computer vision, but currently I'm trying to move in data analytics also. So that's why I came to this course. Thank you.
Awesome, Parveena. Next, please.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sonia Sharma from Nepal. I'm a forest officer under Ministry of Forest and Environment. I'm doing some research work. So this workshop is helpful for me for data analysis.
Very good. Very good. Next, please.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Olu Vashina, Mr. Olu Vashina, you were saying something.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Olu Vashina from Nigeria. I'm expert in solar energy installation. I'm very pleased to be among you today. I would love to upgrade my knowledge as far as data analysis concerned. Thank you very much.
Very good, very good. Most welcome. Who is next? Who is coming next?
Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, but your video is not visible. So anyway, you just introduce yourself. Don't worry about video. You can introduce yourself. Now visible. Yes. Go ahead, please.
Okay, my name is Ade Funke Olaniyo.
Your internet has issues.
I'm a PhD student with the University of Ibadan.
Okay. Hello? Your internet has issue, that's why the sound is cracking. We were not able to hear at all, but it was breaking.
Okay.
No problem. You just speak without video. I think that will be fine.
Okay, hello everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
My name is Adefunke Olaniyo. I'm a PhD student at the University of Ibadan. So I want to update my knowledge on data analysis, and I believe this workshop will be of great use to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. For sure it will be. Anyone else?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
This is Shamima Nasreen from Bangladesh. I am a teacher by profession. I teach university level students, and I also take classes for economics and statistics courses. So also planning for higher studies in future. This year, at the end of this year, I'm planning to apply for some higher study scholarships. So both for my profession and for higher studies, I think I should be introduced to all these statistical softwares so that they can help me in my research activities. So that's why I am learning R. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Very good. Very good. Most welcome. You'll surely learn something from here, and you can explore more for your higher studies. Okay. What next? Who next? Who
is coming hello.
Next? Yes.
Hi, I'm Gobiraj. From Sri Lanka. So I'm doing last 3 years in marine biology research. So I'm collecting field data, and this R will be helpful for interpreting my data collection. So that's why I'm here. Thank you.
Very good. Parveen, sir, are you there?
Just a moment, sir. Yes, I am audible to you.
Yes, perfectly well, sir. We are just
eagerly. But, sir, there is a problem today. I think it is connected with my mobile today because my line is not working, internet line. So I will try to keep it continue, but I think it will not work properly. I hope so.
As much as it works, we'll try, sir.
Yes, yes.
Over to you, sir.
So if does not work, then we continue from tomorrow, and up to we see how much it works, how long it works. Okay. Please you mute your mic. Someone mic is open. Please. So yesterday we have covered about the data types, classifications of the data. And I think we have finished all the classifications of data, or some remains in your batch?
We have just finished two types, according to work and according to nature.
Okay, okay. So let's we continue with third one, which is I will share my screen with you first. So I hope my screen is on your window now. Are you getting this whiteboard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let's we see the third classifications, which is according to function, which we apply in R. Okay, this classification we use in R, mostly R and Python. So first is numeric. Second is our character. Third one is logical. Fourth one is raw. And fifth one is complex. These two are not essential for us in the data analytics part. Numeric, you see, whatever we have the number, that is a numeric data. It may be integer, it may be double, or it may be float. But in R, you will see all these three: integer and numeric and double. So double is specifically we use some packages. Then we see instead of numeric, we get their double. Double means the 2.5, the decimal number, the every real number is comes in this double and the float. float we use in the Python. Okay, instead of double, we apply. There it shows us float. This is a different. This is the same thing. Double and float. Float is the Python, and double we use when we apply the dplyr library. This package we use, we see instead of numeric, we get there double. Okay, then there is integer.
Sir, what is dplyr library?
This package we use for the data manipulation. I will explain you later when we start the R. Okay, practically. So we use many packages over there. Okay. Besides the R basics, we apply some, we use some packages, and with the help of those packages, we could perform analysis in a very smart way. Okay. So these R packages are free. Character, whatever we write in a strings, it may be double quotes or it may be single quotes. So like I am writing here Ram. So, or if I write any number in a single or double quotes, it would be a string. So we could not use those strings or the character in mathematical operation. Is it clear? And in R, it is we say it is a character, but in Python we use it as strings. Okay, the name is different, the thing is same. And the logical means we get the response in true and false. Okay, it is conditional, true and false. Okay, it is a logical, or in Python we say it is a boolean. Okay, so this is the logical response. If I assume assign x is equal to 5, and then if I ask x is greater than 7, so we get false. If I ask x is smaller than 7, we get true. So in this way, we get this logical response. Does that make sense to everyone?
Yes, sir.
So this is all about the classifications of data. We have various classifications we have studied. Three classifications we have studied here. There are few more classifications, but we will not go in that deep. That is not required to us. So I just start new page I take here, and I change the size of page. So and now we study about the measure of central tendency. Measure of center tendency. So everybody knows that what is the measure of central tendency? I think
mean median mode.
Mean median. So this we use to represent our data with a single value. As you know that we select one MP, member of parliament, represent our constituency at a national level in the parliament. Now one person. So similarly, we could not explain the whole data to everyone. We could not show the whole data to everyone. So we give some central tendency. We have decided. We find out that central tendency. That central tendency could say too much about the data. Okay. So it explain. It represent the total data. Whatever the variable you have, it could represent the variable. So for this, we use various central tendency. We have a various method. One is the mean. Second is the median, and third one is mode. So if we see the mean is an aggregate measure. Aggregate means it includes all the numbers. Okay. We involve all the number while calculating the mean. We add on all the number, get the summation of all number when divide by the total numbers. So that is a mean. So it is an aggregate measure. Median, we see we arrange the data in ascending and descending order. Then we divide the data in two parts. That is a partition measure it is. So So we could say it is a partition measure. So it divides the data into part. The middlemost value is called the median. Okay. Third one is the mod. Mod is based on the frequency. It is basically used for the categorical data. So the frequency, highest frequency value is called the mod. So that is the frequency measure. And if we see, if I explain one data here, the small data, 2, 7, 11, 19, 32, 41, and 53. So this data is in arrange form. It is the increasing ascending order. And these values, this is a minimum or this is a maximum value. These values are called the extremes. These are called the extremes of the data. Suppose if I change, instead of 2, if I take 5, so the mean will remain same or change? If I change these extreme values, instead of 53, if I take 54, if I take 49, so mean will change. Mean will not remain same. Okay. So mean is very, very sensitive to extreme values. Mean is very, very sensitive to, it is sensitive to extremes. Okay. Why I am explaining this, I will tell you later on. And if I, what is the mean of this data? Can somebody tell me what is the mean of this data? Yeah. What would be the mean? Yeah, someone tell me. Or may I write on the chat box? The median, I am asking about the median, not the mean, sorry. So what is the median of this data? What would be the median value here? Median 19. Is the middlemost value. Okay. So it is the 19 is our median, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So if I change this value, instead of 2, if I put 5, then the median will change or remain same?
Can you repeat, please?
If I change this extreme value, instead of 5, I am putting, instead of 2, I am using 5.
Median will not change.
Median will not change. So median is not sensitive to extremes. Understand?
Yes.
It is not sensitive to extremes. Not sensitive to extremes. And similarly, the mod will not sensitive to extremes. If you have one data set, you will get only one mean. You will not get two mean. So mean always be a unique in the data, and median will also be unique in the data. But mode may not be unique. It may be more than one also. It may be bimodal, it may be trimodal. So may not be a unique and not always be a unique. Okay. Sometimes it may be bimodal, sometimes it may be trimodal also. Does that make sense to everyone? Yeah.
Yes.
So why I am telling this, why it is sensitive to extremes. So whenever we get data, we got some noisiness in the data, some gangs or the some residuals in the some noise data we get over there, which are not which could mislead our results, our analysis. So we first we give the treatment to those noisy data. So what is the noisy data? Which sort of noisy data we get always when we get the data set? So first thing is the duplicate. duplicate data we get in all respects, the all variables values are. So duplicate.
Looks like we have lost his connection. Let's wait for
a
few minutes.
Okay. We have lost the connection.
Let's continue with our introduction session. Meanwhile, he comes back with his internet. So we can go with other participants who are left for introduction. Please go ahead. Should I go one by one and then much better?
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, yeah. So, go ahead.
I'm Ritu Manandar from Nepal, and I'm a public health student, and it's my last year, so I think this course will help me to do the data analysis in my research. Thank you.
Sure. How did you find the yesterday session and today's session till now?
My friend forwarded me the email or link.
No, I say that. Did you like the yesterday?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Let's go to Swapna ji.
Yes, sir. Myself, Swapnaja. Swapnaja. Actually, I'm basically from Pune, Maharashtra. I completed my master's in bioinformatics and currently pursuing my PhD. In metagenomics.
Okay. And how did you like the yesterday session?
Actually, unfortunately, I have not attended the R1 session yesterday, but I continued with R2.
Okay. So you joined the intermediate course before the foundation course?
We'll let you know.
No, I say that you joined yesterday 7:15, 7 o'clock workshop, right?
The R&D. Yes, 7 to 9. Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Next, anyone else? Please come. I think all of you can speak about yourself and give a little bit introduction about yourself.
Yes, sir. I'm audible.
Many of you have already been. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I'm from India, from Maharashtra.
Mm-hmm. Can't hear you properly. It looks like your internet has some issue. Other participant?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll go to the, let me take, Subhashish ji, would you like to speak about yourself?
Sure, no problem. Hi, yes, everyone.
Please.
Subhashish Banerjee, born and raised in Varanasi, UP. Now living in Manila, Philippines for over 10 years now. Mm-hmm. I am in the business side services. I hold a solution architect portfolio. And I've been working for over 20 years now. There is a lot of data in business, and there is an opportunity to establish relationship trends. And what I'm more interested now is in unstructured data. Mm-hmm. I have a fair bit of development background, and I have studied statistics. I think data science is where all of it comes together. That's why I'm interested in this. Thanks for having me here.
Perfect. Okay, so who wanna introduce yourself? Should go to Mr. Kamrul.
Okay, hi everybody. My name is Kamrul. I'm from Malaysia. Okay, I've joined this course starting yesterday. The beginners and also for the intermediates. So continuation for 4 hours per day. So actually I've been using this R for a couple of years, but I'm still looking for more knowledge on R. And actually I'm more in terms of doing web development and also data visualization with R and also in Python. So it's a meaningful session yesterday. So looking forward for more new things from the presenter. So for your information, I'm a lecturer at one of the public university in Malaysia. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Who is coming next? I see that the most of the videos are off. Can you just switch? Okay, I see another participant with video now.
Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, Mr. Jimo.
Yeah, good afternoon. My name is Jimo Ibrahim. I'm from the Nigerian. And I'm also running my PhD in Amadibele Vestis area in soil science department. Indeed, this R is a very good statistical package, which I intend to learn on how to use it to analyze my data I have some idea about on how to use SAS and HPSS. So I intend to also learn how to use R to do data analysis. And thank you very much for organizing this and free training. Thank you.
Who wants to come next? Ganesh ji, would you like to speak?
Hello, good evening, everyone. Yes, I'm Ganesh Manchaudhary from Nepal. I have been teaching statistics in one of the schools, right? And I'm also working as part-timer in different colleges. So, last time I participated this program, but I could not attend the whole program. I attended three days, I guess. Then again, I requested for the this program, right? I requested for the link and sir helped me. So as a stat teacher, I have to show first, after collecting data, how data are related, or first of all, try to visualize what type of nature of the data is. So first I was using Stata and SPSS before, but in lockdown, I learned myself, right? We can say just by the help of YouTube videos, I learned this pandas, Python pandas and Seaborn and Matplotlib by myself, but I had never touched this R before. So I got the chance by taking this opportunity. I am learning very fast. I can say very fast. I'm getting everything very clearly. And I would like to thank the whole team, Professor, our doctor, I forgot the name, and Mukesh Singh sir, thank you very much for giving this opportunity to all the people, or those who are directly or indirectly benefited from your foundation. Thank you very much. I look forward of this type of program in the near future. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Most welcome. Anyone else next?
Yeah, good afternoon.
Yeah.
Hello, good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, my name is Aguru Benga Uluayomi. I'm from Nigeria Elizade University. I'm a lecturer in the Department of Biological Sciences. So I really appreciate these courses, but due to the unstable in the network, so I'm experiencing some challenges. I just think you can just send the video and the course materials on the platform, because I couldn't enjoy the class due to poor network. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Mrs. Blessing David. I'm calling from Nigeria.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, properly. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'm Mrs. Blessing David. I'm calling from Nigeria. I studied public health and I've been in public health issues for some time. So I help people in analyzing some of their data. I'm familiar with the SPSS, but I've not heard about R before. So this is my first time I've come in contact with the training of last week. Although I also had problem with network issues, I couldn't complete that program. So I'm joining now to gain more knowledge on how to use R. In fact, this is my first time of hearing that about the program. So from the beginning, I enjoyed the starting, but the network gave me issues last time. I intend that maybe this time, the Lord will help me to be able to get better knowledge on how to use the package. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Most welcome. I'm sure this time, everything will work for us. Even sometimes network has no trust, you know, that many times some technical issues, rain or, you know, that
yes.
give problem. But don't worry. We are here. To,
also,
we are always
also here. You promised us to give a note, but I've not been able to access the notes.
No problem. Just mail us. We will support you. Mail us.
It's okay. It's all right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Who is coming next? Shubham, would you like to speak? Shubham Kale?
Yes, sir. My voice is audible to you?
Yeah.
Yes, I'm from Maharashtra, Mumbai.
Yes.
I'm posting BTEC in IT. Finally. Yes. Yes.
Young participants we have. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, I'm pursuing BTEC in IT final year.
Okay. And yeah. how did you find this workshop? Like, you know that?
On Telegram, sir. I found it on Telegram.
Okay. So you enjoyed yesterday's session?
Yeah, sir. Definitely. It was really good for me.
Good to see the young guys like you are interested in data science. Surely
yeah.
Do best. Best of luck.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Who is coming next?
Hello, everyone. Hello, Mukesh sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I am Muzaffar, and I am doing my PhD on wildlife ecology. I'm from Jammu and Kashmir, India.
Okay. Wonderful. Who is coming next? So let me call Dr. Parmar now, if the network is okay now. Just a second, give me 1 minute. Huh? Meanwhile, if somebody want to give a, you know, that their introduction, please go ahead. Huh? Don't worry about it.
Hello everyone. I am Humaira from Pakistan, and I am pursuing MPhil education from Islam University of Bahawalpur. And now this session can from knowledge SPSS according to what is scale, frequency, percentage, mean, median, mode about this session. Yesterday's session is a very interactive and interesting. So
thank you, Humaira. Thank you. Next, please.
Sir, I need to ask something from Humaira. Humaira, can you listen to me, please? Hello?
Yes.
Humaira, had you submitted your dues?
No.
Actually, I'm facing problem while creating signing in the PayPal. That's why I'm asking. Anyone else? Ikra Ashraf, I think she is also from Pakistan. Please let me know how you people have to submit.
I don't know about this. Who is Ikra? And I am Humaira. And inshallah, I will pay it tomorrow and send receipt.
Okay, then please also guide me, okay?
Okay, thank you so much.
I think PayPal is the best way for payment for internet.
No, PayPal is no providing in Pakistan. So, account.
Maybe some known from, you know, that different part of the world. If you know somebody,
yes.
PayPal is the best.
Yeah, PayPal is not available in Pakistan. So, account number is...
Your friend circle, somebody, if you know some friend circle in India or other part of the world, they have PayPal there. So, that's the best way to get the international payment.
So, how to send...
We don't have any other payment gateway for international payment. That's why we use PayPal.
I have no any idea about this, how to pay fees. So, so many difficulties. And today's session...
Actually, I have tried a lot tonight, but I was facing problem. That's why I'm waiting here that someone from Pakistan and who did payments to guide me how they have submitted video. Anyways, thank you.
Thank you. Kindly guide me.
Guys, I just had a word with Dr. Parmar. He said that let's give a break for 15 minutes. 15 minutes break. So we are meeting 6:15, right? Take a tea, coffee, have a break, and then come back 6:15 or 6:20. We'll start. I write it in a chat box for everybody. Let's back on 6:15.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So that will be much better. So you can do your 15 minutes job, get refreshed, have some tea, coffee. Let's get back on 6:15. Thank you very much.
Should we leave the meeting or we just leave at this?
Keep the meeting on. You can just take a break and come back.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Hello. Ready.
Sir, we have given break till 6:15. Let's wait for 2 more minutes and then we start.
Okay.
6:15, they will back. Most of the participants have taken break. 6:15. Hmm. We can start, sir.
Okay, sir. Hi, everyone. Let's continue the session. Let me share my screen with you. So, I think, are you able to see this whiteboard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we were talking about the outliers. We were talking about the value which are very different from the remaining data points are called outliers. So as we think in our workshop, what should be the range of the participants? Yeah. Age range, range of the age. Can someone guess it? What should be the range of the participants in our workshop?
I guess there is no such restriction.
No such restriction. It's okay. But what should be in this sort of course?
Sir, 18 to 40?
40, 50. We could write 60. Okay. 18 to 60. It's okay.
Yes, sir.
It should be the general range. Okay. So 18 to 60, if someone is 14 years old person is attending our workshop, or here the 82 years old person is attending our workshop. So these are the outliers. We know that still they are attending this one. Okay. But they are outliers for us. If we include these values in our analysis, it will mislead our results. Okay, sometimes we get some outliers, the values which are very different from the other values of the data. So they are treated as outliers, and then we give some treatment to these outliers. And one of the treatment is we impute some other value instead of 82. So what we do the capping and flooring. Generally, so when we do the capping, we put instead of 82, we put 60. So it is now here. And instead of 14, it is called the flooring on the left side. So we put instead of 14, we put 18. So it will go here. So whenever you do this sort of thing, and you have calculated the mean previously, you have already calculated the mean and you have written somewhere. And when you work with these extreme values, these are the extreme values, 82 and 14. So these are the extreme values, then what will happen? The mean will change. Okay. At that moment, you have to again calculate the mean of that particular variable. And then use that new mean. That makes sense to everyone? So I have written here the sensitivity to extremes. it is sensitive to extremes. If we are changing the extreme values, we must have to calculate the mean again. And then we have to apply the new mean. Okay. So this is all about what I want to tell. We will see later on what are the other treatments for the outliers, what are the treatments for the missing values or the duplicate data. We will see later on in practical. But here, after the measure of central tendency, we basically, in this workshop, we will study up to the descriptive analysis. Okay, finally, we will study the descriptive analysis. In the descriptive analysis, there are many parts. One is the univariate analysis. Univariate analysis, why we perform this analysis is because we want to understand the behavior and nature of the variable, of each variable. You suppose in a family, there are 8 members in a family, and every member has a different nature and the different behavior. Similarly, in our data set or the data frame, we have many variables and each variable has a different nature and behavior. So we have to understand the behavior and nature of the each variable so we could perform a good analysis. Okay. So 3 things is required for univariate analysis for understanding the behavior and nature of the variable. First is the measure of central tendency. Second is the measure of dispersion. And third one is the shape of the data. Shape of the data, we see the histogram and the bar plot. Okay. Through the histogram and not the bar plot. We use mostly box plot for the continuous data. So this we use for finding out the shape of the data. Okay, through these 3 measurement or the shape of the 2 measurement, the second and third one is the shape of the data, or we could say the skewness. And we could understand the behavior of the data. We could understand the nature of the data. So second thing we are going to start the measure of dispersion. So can someone tell me what does it mean by dispersion? Yeah.
Measure of spread.
Measure? Yeah.
Spread.
Spread, correct. Some other thing? Someone else?
Scattered. Variance?
Scatter, correct. Variance is a measurement. There are 2 things. One is in the dispersion. One is the spreadness. Other one is the scatterness. How far from the mean? That is the deviation. Okay, Praveen Nath. So spreadness is what? It is between 2 points of the data. Okay. And just like if we see the range of the data. So range is what? Range is maximum value minus minimum value. That is the range. How your data is spread. And how long is your data spread. So that is a range. Suppose if I write, please you mute yourself. 2, 7, 9, 14, 32, 51. If we find out the spread of range of this data, so 51 minus 2, that is a 51 minus 2, that is 49 is the
49
is the spreadness. So we have some other measurement of the spreadness also, interquartile range, quartile deviation. I will explain you after this. One more thing I would like to explain you. Suppose we have this data here. This is our 0, then 2. I change the colors, which is a very light color. I change some color, dark color. So it is 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30. This we have a data. Okay. And we are taking one data, one sample from this data set. One sample is here, this one, sample A. And this one is our sample B. Okay. So what would be the range of A? Maximum value is 10, minimum value is 2.
8.
8. And what would be the range of B? Maximum value is 28 and the minimum value is 20. This is also 8.
26. 6. 6.
No, no. 28 minus 20.
20.
Okay.
To 8.
So we are getting both range same. Okay, if I just give you the range, so can you go to some conclusion? Can you perform some analysis if I just give you the range of two data set, which is the equal range? Only I give you the range. I am not giving you some other thing. We could not go to any conclusion. Okay, not possible. Because the range is an absolute measure. It is an absolute measure. We have a two sort of measure in the statistics. It is an absolute measure. Whenever you get the absolute measure, you could not go to any conclusion. Okay. But if you have a relative measure, then you could go to some conclusion. We can reach some at some conclusion. So we see what is the relative measure. Relative measure, you see, one of the relative measure we use in the correlation analysis. We always, what we use in the correlation analysis, we find out the value of correlation. What you find out in the correlation? Can someone tell me? Yeah, what we find out? We directly find out the correlation value, or we do something else? Some other measurement we use?
It is the relation between the two data set.
So what we find it out?
What is the variance in that?
Variance is that, no, but in the correlation, what we find out?
How much one variable?
No, that's the your explanation. What we find out? Only the correlation value or something else? The name is what? We find out the coefficients, no? We found out the coefficients of correlation. We don't find out the correlation. Understand? That is the coefficient of correlation because it is a relative measure. We see the relation between two variables. Either it is positive or negative relation or neutral. So coefficients are always the relative measure. Does that make sense to everyone? So what we will do here, instead of range, we take the coefficient of range. So which will provide us some relative measure. Does that make sense to everyone? So what is the coefficient of range? What would be the formula of coefficient of range? It is the maximum minus minimum over maximum plus minimum. Okay, so now we find out the coefficient of range of a data set. So it is in the numerator it is 8, but in denominator if you calculate 2 plus 10 is equal to 12. So we get 0.67. Does that make sense to everyone? Coefficient of range of A, it is 0.67 now. And if I calculate the coefficient of range of B, it is 8 over 20 plus 28, it is 48, it is 1 over 6, which means 0.167 thereabout. Okay, so if we have 0.167 here. Okay, so now if I provide you along with range, I say the range is same, but the coefficient of range is this much. So now you could analyze something. You see this and can you say something now? Can you correlate the data and the coefficient of range? Whatever the sample you have taken in the coefficient of range, can you correlate now? Yeah. Yeah, someone can correlate the data and the coefficient of correlation. Yeah. No one is correlate this data and this correlation coefficient. Oh, sorry, this coefficient of range. Coefficient of range and this data. Can you correlate now? Correct. Pravinath, you are telling right that A data set is contain low values data and the B data is containing high value data. And whenever the low value data, the coefficient of range would be higher. Coefficient of range would be higher. If there is high coefficient of range, it means the data belongs to low values. That makes sense to everyone. You see, here is the low value data, no? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, these are the low values. Okay. And these are the high values, the 20, 22, 24, 26, 28. If you go beyond this, you will get less coefficient of range. Suppose there are two companies, A and B. Suppose X and Y, not A and B, X and Y companies, and both has given you to one offer letter. And they have mentioned their coefficient of range of the salary of the employees in that offer letter. They have not mentioned your salary, but they have first mentioned the coefficient of range of the salaries of the employee. Company X has 0.42 coefficient of range and company B has 0.21. So which company you would prefer on the basis of this coefficient of range? Correct. Y, correct. We'll prefer the Y company because the coefficient of range is low, means there it would be a high salary. Okay, the employees are getting the high salary. So does that make sense to everyone? Every statistics provide you some information about the data. Every statistics. So you see here the dispersion. In the dispersion, we are studying about the spreadness. In the spreadness, you are getting that it is providing us information about the data. And from where this it has come. That makes sense to everyone. High value or the low value data, it provides us that information. So it is the first spreadness. Now we see the second spreadness is again between two points, or that is the interquartile range. Or that is generally we say right IQR. And this is Q3 minus Q1, and third quartile minus first quartile. And if we see the coefficient of this, coefficient of IQR, it would be Q3 minus Q1 upon Q3 plus Q1. Whenever we have a data points, we are taking the difference between two data points, this sort of spreadness whenever we will measure, we will divide by the addition of those 2 points and the summation of 2 points. And there is another measurement, which is the semi interquartile range. Semi interquartile range. This is also known as quartile deviation. And the formula for this is Q3 minus Q1 over 2. And when find out the coefficient of quartile deviation, it would be same. Why? Because we will write the Q3 minus Q1 over 2 and Q3 plus Q1 over, just a moment, I take this there, 2. 2 and 2 will eliminate to each other. So we get again Q3 minus Q1 upon Q3 plus Q1. So this would be same. Okay. So in the in this interquartile range, what happens? Quartile, I will explain you. It is a member of median family. Quartile is a member of median family. So for median family, there is a condition, we arrange the data in ascending or descending order, then we could perform something. So here I am telling you that it is our median, which are divide, partition the data in 2 parts, 50% above and the 50% below. And this is our minimum value. And this is our maximum value. And here we are getting 50% of data. Here we are getting 50% of data. Does that make sense to everyone? Now there are some few points. We divide the data in 4 parts now, 4 equal parts. So that is the first quartile. We'll divide this 50% in 2 parts. The 25% would be here and the 25% would be here. Okay. There is another, we are dividing it by Q3. So here also you will get the 25% and 25%. If I am talking about the Q3 minus Q1, then we are working only with the 50% of data, which is the dense data. Basically, if there is a normally distributed data, so you see this is the frequency on the middle of the data will be higher. If you see in the class, the marks obtained by the students, the low marks students would be very few students who got the marks below 40, and the students are getting marks above 60 is also very low, very few students. But in general, the normal sense, we see the students who are getting the marks between 40 and 60, they are in the more quantity. Okay. So that is a normal distribution. So here we get in between, we get the dense data, you see. So here, whenever we are getting here, the scatterness is too high. Here also the scatterness is too high. Then we choose the data between Q3 and Q1. We work on only 50% data. Okay. And this thing is called the whisker. This is the upper lower whisker and this is the upper whisker. And the mean of this data, generally called the trimmed. Okay. So now you got what is first quartile and the third quartile. Yeah. Is it clear to you? So it was the spreadness. It was all about the spreadness. Now we see the scatterness. What is scatterness? I write few data here. I just see what's the difference is 5, here the difference is 6, here the difference is 12, and here the difference is 3, 1, 13, here the difference is, you see, the 17, which is 9, and I think the difference is 6, 28, 25, 45. You see, there's the difference from here, these two consecutive numbers. Here also the difference between two consecutive numbers we are calculating. And this difference, we are getting the summation of this difference. What we are getting over here. So we are getting here, I think that it is 45. Am I correct? If my calculation is right, you also may calculate this. 5 plus 6, 11. 11 plus 9, 20. 20 and 25. It is the 45. And I find out the mean of this. So I have the 5 differences. So I will divide by 5. It is the average scatterness of the data. Average scatterness, if I put this from 2 plus 9, so I will get the second value 11. 11 plus 9, I will get the second value 20. Third value 20. 20 plus 9, I will get 29. 29 plus 9, I will get 38. 38 plus 9, I will get 47. So you see, now the difference is 99. And we have all data points. How many data points? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Does that make sense to everyone? So this is basically average scatterness. Or we see here the scatterness, the 5, the here the 6, the 12, 13, 9. So it is not a evenly scattered data. But this is not a good measurement. No, average scatterness is not a measurement. But it is just for the understanding what does it mean by the scatterness. Okay. And scatterness we are getting from these consecutive points difference from these consecutive points, but in the spreadness you see we get the difference between two points only. Here we get the scatterness with the in the various points. We see the difference between deviation between or the difference between various points, and you know, not only two. So this 2 point, then this 2 point, then this 2 point. So they have thought that we should take the scatterness through some measure of central tendency. We have to calculate the deviation from the measure of some central tendency point, and then we could find out the average of that. So that is called a mean absolute deviation or the mean deviation. You know? So I will explain you first that thing. These are the data points we have. Okay. Hypothetically, I am explaining you so you could better understand this thing. Okay. These are the data points we have. And this is our X1. Yeah, I will explain you data examples. Don't worry. So I am explaining this thing. So I will explain you that example also. X3. X4, X5. In this way, we have Xn data. Here is the Xn minus 1. And in this way, we are getting data. And we have center tendencies also. Here we have X bar. Here we have median. Here we have mod. These are our data points. These are the data points that we have. And what I do, I find out the deviation of each data point from the mean. So I will see the difference from here to here. Then I will get the difference from here to here. Then I will get the difference from here to here. Then I will get the difference from here to here. Then I will get the difference from here to here. I will get the difference from each point. Okay. From each point. This deviation. From each point, I am not mentioning all the points. I am not drawing it. Now, what we do, what I am doing here, I am using xi, xi I means I from 1 to n, and this deviation from mean. If I try to get the summation of this, I will get 0, because the sum value may be positive or sum may be negative. If I add on this all deviations, I will get always 0, because it is from the actual mean. Does that, are you agree with this? You could do it practically. You take a small data set and you find out the mean, and then you find out the deviation from mean, and you calculate, you sum up it, you will get the 0 value. Okay. So what I will do, I will just take xi minus x bar. I will take the modulus of this deviation first. So when I take the modulus, the negative value will convert in positive, and positive will remain the positive. So now I will get some value in the summation. If I get the summation of this all, so I will get some value of the deviation, and then I divide it by n. So it is the mean of deviations. Is it clear? It is the mean of deviation. But this deviation is taken from through mean. This deviation of each data point is taken through mean. So it is the mean of deviation, and the it is called delta x bar. And this thing is called the mean absolute deviation. Basically, it is called mean absolute deviation, mean of absolute deviation. We are taking the absolute deviation. We are using the modulus here. We are taking the absolute deviation, and then we are finding out the mean. So mean of absolute deviation. So off is here, the mean of absolute deviation, off is silent here. Understand this thing, mean absolute deviation, or it is written as a MAD. Does that make sense to everyone? We could take the this deviation from median also of each data point. So at that moment, what will happen? Xi minus ME, and we get the absolute value of this deviation. Then we get the summation and divide by n. So it is also a mean absolute deviation, mean of absolute deviation, but through median. We have taken the deviation through median, and this we write in this way. Does that make sense to everyone? And the third thing, we could take this deviation through the mod also. So it is xi minus z over n, and this summation, sorry, and delta z. It is also a mean absolute deviation. Does that make sense to everyone? We have three mean absolute deviations. One through the mean, second through the median, and third through the mod. And if we find out the coefficient of this, the coefficient of this, I just write here coefficient, and it is the delta x bar, whatever the deviation you are getting, and from which you are getting the deviation, through which. So we are taking through the mean. Here we get the coefficient of mean absolute deviation, delta ME over ME. And here we take delta Z over Z. Does that make sense to everyone? Here we use that measure of center tendency by which we have taken the deviation in the denominator. Is there any doubt, anyone? Okay. Now, one more thing I would, there were three demerits in this method, mean absolute deviation. We have three demerits here. One is, it is not confirmed that which central tendency we have to use. If I just write the MAD is 25 of some data, can you guess from through which central tendency I have find out this mean absolute deviation? Can you guess if I just write the MAD? We could not guess it. Okay. So that is the first demerit. There is no first is there is no fixed center tendency. There is no we could say the standard central tendency. Standard central tendency by which we are taking the deviation. First demerit is this. Second demerit is algebraically to convert negative into positive is wrong. Algebraically modulus is not applicable. Usable or applicable, you could write that. Okay. Arithmetically, it is okay. You are convert, you are taking the absolute value, you are converting the negative into positive. But algebraically, it is not okay because we will write the formula algebraically with the generic application of the formula. So we have to use the algebra here. Third thing, which is also very important, it is the unidirectional. Unidirectional means, you see here, we have these all values. Can you get the negative value here for delta x bar, delta me and delta z? Can we get the negative one here? We cannot. But deviation, you see, if you, I am give one example of the deviation. There is a pendulum you have seen in the watch, in the, sorry, wall clock. We see the pendulum, it deviate. It deviates in the both direction, not only the one. Okay. In the both direction it deviates. So here, if I write that, suppose I am going to tell you that there is a marks, average marks of the mathematics in three different sections of 10th standard in a school. And this is the mean marks of first A section. This is the mean marks of B section. And this is the mean marks of C section. Suppose it is the 45 is the mean marks. Here the 62 is the mean marks. Here the 35 is the mean marks. And I'm also giving the deviation, mean absolute deviation. So when I am putting this line, so it will be on the one direction, on the positive direction, I will get that. Suppose here is the 7 mean absolute deviation. Here is 9 mean absolute deviation. And here is 5
sir,
mean absolute
screen.
Deviation. Yeah.
Your screen is not showing.
My screen is not showing. Can someone explain? My screen is visible or not? Yeah.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Sir, it's visible.
Sir, visible.
Sure. So please you log out and log in again. Okay. So it would be visible to you. It may be some problem from the Zoom application. Okay. Please you log out and log in. Okay. So you see, it is the one directional only. The deviation should be in the both direction. It should be downward also. It should from the median on the both direction. Understand? Average deviation. It is the average deviation. Mean absolute, mean of absolute deviation. The average, how average your data is deviated. Averagely, the data is deviating. Okay, the, there is a minimum value and the maximum value. It is the spreadness is there, but we are talking about the scatterness. Now here we are talking about the scatterness, how averagely your data is deviated. Average. Now visible, okay. So it is the one direction only. We could not put in this direction. So they have decided to, we should have to use some other measure, other method, which should be standard. So they have given a name, standard deviation. They have told that there should be something standard. We have to standardize this thing. So they have given the name itself, the standard deviation. They have standardized the things. First demerit we had, there are no specific measure of center tendency. Here is the standard deviation always be taken through the mean. No, not from the median and mod. So mean is fixed here. We will get the deviation through mean only. Okay. First thing. Second thing, to convert the negative into positive, we want to use the modulus. We use some other technique, which is applicable algebraically also. So if I write -2, I get the square of this, I will get the positive value 4, or 2, 4 also, I will get the positive 4. So what they have done, they have taken the square, they have used the square of deviation. Okay. And third thing, it is the unidirectional, and after getting the mean of square of deviation, they have taken the square root of that. I will explain you through the formula so you could better understand. So it is the xi minus x bar, and they are taking the square of this, and then we are getting the summation of this, and then we are dividing it by n. So it is the mean of square of deviation. Does that make sense to everyone? And finally, we are taking the square root of this. When you take the square root, you will get the plus and minus both. So it is the deviation on the both side, negative side and the positive side. Does that make sense to everyone? Upward and downward. Is there any doubt? Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. Now, we see the coefficient of this, coefficient of SD, standard deviation. And this standard deviation coefficient is sigma over mean, as I explained earlier in the case of mean absolute deviation coefficient. And there is a variance also. Variance is nothing. It is just a square of standard deviation. If we don't take the square root, then it is a variance. So it is the sigma square basically, or that is sigma xi minus x bar square over n, this much. And if we see the coefficient of variance, that is equal to sigma over x bar into 100, or sometimes we use percent also. So there is the same thing. Sigma over x bar. Here we are not using the sigma square. Sigma over x bar into 100. So this is the coefficient of variance. Is there any doubt? Someone has some question? May ask me. Yeah. Nobody has any question?
The coefficient and variance is multiplied with 100%. Why?
It is, they have given some distinction between them.
Okay.
So when you have to, this we use for the find out the consistency of the data. If you have to measure the consistency of the data, somebody tell you, you find out the consistency of the data. Generally, we measure the variance. And the variance, we see how the variability we could judge through the variance. But we have to measure it. है ना, तो वी वॉन्ट यूज द वेरियंस, वी आर मेजरिंग द कंसिस्टेंसी, वी आर मेजरिंग द स्टेबिलिटी ऑफ द डेटा, और वी आर मेजरिंग द वेरिएबिलिटी ऑफ द डेटा, देन वी यूज द कोएफिशिएंट ऑफ वेरियंस, वी मेजर द कोएफिशिएंट ऑफ वेरियंस, नॉट ओनली वेरियंस, है ना. सो द वेयर एवर द लो वेरियंस, इट इज द मोर कंसिस्टेंट डेटा, मोर स्टेबल डेटा. ओके, और देर इज अ हाई वेरियंस, इट मीन्स लेस कंसिस्टेंट डेटा, लेस स्टेबल डेटा, और वी कुड से द हाई वेरिएबिलिटी डेटा, द हाई कोएफिशिएंट ऑफ वेरियंस. डज दैट मेक सेंस टू एवरीवन? Sorry, just a moment. Yeah, n is a sample size. Correct. Correct, Praveen Nanji. N is the sample size. How many data points are there for that? Okay. So this was all about our today's session, and I just explain you how to download R and R programming, and then we wind up this session. We have 1 minute, 2 minute times. So you could take more time, 1-2 minute. Okay. So all of you have to download R programming, then download the R Studio. So I explain you how to download R programming and R Studio. So you just write on the search, Google search, download R programming. And when you write this, you will get one cran.r-project.org. If you have the Windows, then you could select one. Okay. So if you have Mac, you could search for the Mac also. And here the download 4.0.3 for Windows. You click on here and it will be downloaded. It is in the both 32-bit and the 64-bit. We have 85 megabytes. It is the space it's taking. And download it and then run it. So it will be installed. Follow the instruction. Don't change the path and anything. Okay, if you change the path, then it will be you will not work when you download the library or the packages.
So show you a screen.
Will not work. So first you have to install this R programming, and then you have to install the R Studio. So R Studio download. So it is a very simple site name, rstudio.com, and you just click on it, and you will see you are getting here four things, not only one: the R Studio Desktop, R Studio Desktop Pro, R Studio Server, and R Studio Server Pro. So you have to choose the R Studio Desktop. So you could run without internet also. But whenever you have to download the package, then you have to requirement of the internet. And otherwise, you could apply the import the library. When you have once downloaded, you could import the library without internet connection. So this free version you have to choose, and you just click on the download. You will get the here, and you click on here. It will be downloaded in your system. It is in the 64-bit, and for the 32-bit system. So you could see here the older version. On the downward, okay, you have to click here. If you have the 64-bit, it's okay. So you download it and run it. Automatically, it will integrate to the R programming. Okay. Is anybody has any doubt? I have not. I have not shared the screen. No? Okay. So it's the R. I will again explain you. You just write down the download R programming. Are you getting it? And here you see cran.r-project.org. Then click on this. And then here, if you have the Windows, you could click here. It will be downloaded in your system. And then you run it for the installation. And don't change the path. You know, whatever the path it will take in the C directory, then the default path you have to use. So after installing it, you download the R Studio. So you just have to write down the download R Studio in the Google search. You will get rstudio.com, and you click on it. You will get this page. And here you see the RStudio desktop, RStudio desktop pro, RStudio server, and RStudio server pro. So these are the licensed version. These are the free two. And we will prefer the RStudio desktop. Okay. RStudio server you could also install, but better to use first RStudio desktop. Later on you could use it. And when you click here, you will go to here. And here is the 64-bit. It is a 64-bit version we are getting. And if you require the, it is the 64-bit you see here. If you you have 32-bit, then you could go for the older version from here. And just click here, it will be downloaded. Also run this, okay? Don't change the path and it will automatically be integrated. Okay, you do this thing only. And the tomorrow we see how to run this. Is there any doubt? No. First, you have to install the R programming, then RStudio. I will explain you what is R programming, what is RStudio tomorrow in detail. Okay. So try to install this. Mr. Mukesh, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Over to you.
And the workshop now, sir, because another team is waiting for the
next. Yeah, yeah.
All those who are participating in our intermediate can join the next workshop immediately after this workshop. And so thank you very much. Let's connect tomorrow. Sorry for delay today, just because of internet issue. Now internet is fixed, so tomorrow we'll have maybe we'll start earlier. 5 o'clock sharp we'll start. So see you then tomorrow. Have a nice evening. Bye bye.
Okay, bye everyone.
Good night.
Bye. Thanks everyone. Thanks everyone. Okay.